fail. In the words of Dr. Martin Luther King, this is the fierce urgency of now. This is an urgent moment. Dr. King was more than a dreamer. He was a drum major for justice and peace and equality. He wanted a better world, and he was willing to fight for it and struggle for it, and he was willing to use his voice and his talent to help save a people, and not just black people. When Dr. King took to the stage, he spoke for the dispossessed, the disinherited, the disenfranchised. He spoke up for everyone. And so you can imagine if Dr. King had lived to see this moment, he would have rejoiced. There's no question Dr. King had an assassin bullet not taken him from us on April 4th, 1968, would have rejoiced in seeing our nation's first black president. He would have celebrated. He would have been on that platform like his sister and his son and daughter. He would have been glad to see Michelle Obama in the White House, sleeveless, in the garden, working with military families. He would have been proud of Sasha and Malia. He would have been associated with the progress that we have made and the struggles that we have continued. But he would have reminded us the day after the inaugural celebration. He would have reminded us of the fierce urgency of now. And he would have told us to get back to work, because our work is not yet completed. I don't have to remind you that Dr. King would have continued to march for freedom and justice and equality. He would have started the day after by reminding us that the unemployment rate in his country was just horrible. He would not have waited for African Americans, the unemployment rate of African Americans, to almost reach 18%, and in some cities, 45 to 50%. He would have started his march long before the ink on the stimulus plan was dry, and he would have said, this plan, this proposal must go to those most in need. He would have marched until he followed the money into communities, distressed communities all over the country. Dr. King would not have waited for Speaker Pelosi and Majority Leader Reid to call him to the Capitol Hill. He would have marched on the Capitol and demanded that the money be spent wisely and to be given to those who had lost everything. Dr. King would not have waited to see 33 million Americans waiting to get their home mortgage loans refinanced. He would have marched on every bank, the Bank of America, the Bank of Commerce, because Dr. King had a much larger institution. It was called the Bank of Justice, and he knew that they had not made any significant deposit. And he would have reminded us that they had exploited the bank, and therefore they had to redeposit the capital. He would have urged Congress to close the opportunity gap. He would not wait for the polls before he told Congress that No Child Left Behind was a nice slogan, a cliche, but as long as one out of three minority students are dropping out of school, they better go and save them and stop giving us useless sound bites that had no resources behind them. Oh, yeah, Dr. King would have enjoyed attending hearings because he would have been proud of the Congress for giving its whip to Jim Clyburn of California. It would have been nice to see a black man from South Carolina with the whip. Oh, yes, Dr. King would have been proud of seeing even a woman in a chair in Speaker Pelosi. Even though she wears Prada, he would have been proud of that, too. He would have been delighted to know that the House Homeland Security Committee was chaired by a man from Mississippi, not far from the birthplace of Fannie Lou Hamer, the gravesite of Channing Goodwin and attorney. Dr. King would have been proud of Benny Thompson. He would have been delighted to know that the Judiciary Committee was chaired by John Conyers of Detroit. And yes, we finally have a hate crimes law. Dr. King would have been proud of that. He would have been at the signing. He would have been proud to know that the House Government Affairs Committee was chaired by a man from New York, Ed Towns. And yes, the Ways and Means Committee, chaired by another man from New York, Harlem, Charlie Ringel. He would have been pleased to visit the states of New York and Massachusetts to see two black governors, blacks serving in prominent roles, CEOs. Yes, he would have probably coached Tiger Woods, Serena Williams and Venus and Kobe Bryant, and would have been proud to know that African-American men are now coaching in the NFL. But Dr. King would have still reminded us that we had to keep marching and keep fighting and keep the dream alive and to build upon it and to ensure that injustice anywhere was a threat to justice everywhere. So Dr. King would have never tired in defending the poor, no matter if they lived in my hometown of New Orleans, stuck in the clammy floodwaters of Katrina for days. He would have marched until every ounce of debris was removed, the levees restored, people back in their homes, the musicians back in the quarters. And yes, the chefs stirring up mouth-watering jambalaya and gumbo. Dr. King would not sit around and wait until the rescue personnel found another body in Haiti. He would not have waited for the medical supplies to reach the people. He would have cried out, and he would have spoken out, and he would have summoned us, as you're being summoned today by the Haiti Relief Fund here on campus, to give and donate as much as you can. Dr. King would have did what I did 2 weeks ago and emailed Anderson Cooper and said, Anderson, they're not just throwing bodies in the ground. They're trying to bury their dead, their mothers, their fathers, their sisters and brothers. And so you also speak of them with dignity. These are not just dead bodies and bones. They're people. They're human beings that once lived a great life, and now they must be buried in dignity. Dr. King would not have forsaken anybody who needed his help or who needed him to speak out. But Dr. King would have told us not to fear the enemies of freedom, those who simply would like to see the president fail. He would tell us that though we don't listen to Rush Limbaugh or Glenn Beck or Pat Robertson, don't fear these men. And don't hate them. Dr. King believed that love was the most powerful weapon in the universe, that love could conquer anything. He believed in the scripture that you love your enemies, you bless them that curse you, and you do good to them that hate you, and pray for them that despise you and persecute you. But you don't forget their evil ways. And you don't embrace their evil acts, but you love them so that you can move forward. Dr. King simply would have kept his dream alive and would have urged you not to be comfortable, to not sit back and wait, and not to celebrate too long, but to keep the dream alive by working each and every day to build upon it and to strengthen it and to ensure that every child had a head start and a healthy start in life.